Hello, welcome to Connie Martin's and Talks Books. I'm only laughing because my guest has written such a unique book that from the cover that has a hole in it to the words that are written in this book, it is unique. It is written by my guest, Pamela Ribbon. It's called Notes to Boys, and it includes, may I say, she was able to write a 200-page letter to one. At least that's not here. It is a mortifying memoir from the best-selling author of Going in Circles and Why Girls Are Weird. It's published by Rare Birds Press. Welcome, Pam.
Thank you. Hi.
Truly unique, brilliant, original.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Thanks.
So let's start how it opens with it's your birthday and there's somebody who every year on his birthday you call and on yours he gets in touch with you.
That's true, these days. Back then I just really liked him.
Oh.
Luckily, that's how it ends up turning out. But when it opens, I'm trying to tell him how much I like him by forcing him to watch broadcast news with me.
Uh-huh.
But the problem is we were 13 years old, so he didn't quite get it.
And he's the one you invite for a weekend, and he comes.
Yes.
And you're 13.
Yes.
And you want him to swear on dying love. And so in the middle of the night, you go to his room. And you wake him up in essence and jump on him. And he says, no, 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 there's someone else I'm in love with.
Yes. So we did get a very emotional grown-up-y scene. It just didn't go the way I would have written it.
You must have been much of a reader.
I was very much a reader.
And of grown-up books.
Yes, that's true. I started reading, my parents found me reading when I was about 3 years old.
Yep.
So I had run out of Beverly Cleary by the time I was four. And then because my parents weren't sure what to give me, when I was eight, I believe they gave me Stephen King's Pet Sematary.
Yeah.
So I was reading a lot of grown-up books from a pretty early age. Yes.
Because one gets the feeling you were reading books like Forever Amber. And it would have been
I was sneaking some Judy Blume in, for sure, yes.
Or 52 Shades as you were going through.
Yeah. Yes, I guess. I read Endless Love at a very impressionable age.
Yeah.
Yes.
Describe the book to friends.
Describe the book to friends?
Yeah.
Basically, I moved around a lot, and so I was often home alone. I had a younger sister, and both my parents worked. So I had a lot of time to myself. And because this was before the internet, I basically wrote notes to boys that I would give to them in school the next day.
But what I love, you kept a copy of everything.
I kept a copy. Well, I kept the first draft, and I gave them a more finished, no scribbles. They need it needs to be, a little more polished. And I kept them all because I'm a
you
small
You knew you were going to be a writer.
Maybe. Yes, maybe I wanted one day to leave a legacy. But I started reading them at book signings and book appearances because they make people do this a lot. I enjoy an audience that's covering their face. So then someone asked to publish them. So.
Well, you do sort of point them at the definite spot. You're 15 years old at most of this.
Yes.
But then it goes up to 19.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
We should mention that it's not just the letters. I'm commenting on them.
Yeah.
Yes. As a grown-up,
yes.
Looking back at how ridiculous I was.
Well, some of it you had to like, because some of it wasn't bad at all.
Well, thanks.
Yeah.
I certainly thought I was being poetic when I talked about Bottles of Rain.
Yes. But in 1991, you wrote Writing in a Red Pen. That was different from your other writing. And that was, someone got out her Nine Inch Nails album, she says.
Yeah. I started becoming more graphic in my letters.
Yeah.
Yes.
And a red pen does it.
Right. You have a lot of hormones at that age.
Yeah. And today, of course, you are a comedy writer.
That's right.
Using the book at all?
Yes. Well, comedy is pain. So I certainly remember all of these feelings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What have you written that's comedy? The Why Girls Are Weird?
Yes, Why Girls Are Weird. The novels are they're comedic fiction. Yes. Mm-hmm. This is my first nonfiction. Normally I can hide behind saying that it's not a true story.
Yeah.
And I've written for a few sitcoms and things like that.
Well, I did like How to Smell Like Holly Hunter Boy, mm-hmm. a recipe. Now, Holly Hunter Boy, you really want him to watch, what was it?
Broadcast News.
Yeah,
yes.
Bat News.
Because I'm Albert Brooks, and, uh-huh. and he's Holly Hunter, in my fantasy when I was 13.
That's interesting.
I know that I identified with Albert Brooks.
Have you ever met him?
No, I've not.
I wonder if he knows about it.
No, I don't think he does. I follow him on Twitter. That's as close as our relationship is.
Wait till he hears this.
Yes. I can sing while I read. That's
yes.
the other thing. You know, that's a good line from the movie.
Now, we're at the Sea of Pain University of Texas.
Okay.
Not always the ideal date.
I'm not even sure. These are all so embarrassing that sometimes I'm not sure which embarrassing moment you're asking me to talk about. And I don't want to talk about the wrong one. Why would I offer up
but
a worse story than you want?
It was interesting how in January 1991, you switch from being I to the third person.
Yeah.
And you talk about yourself as she.
Oh, yeah. I start, they're stories, right? I start trying to write some fiction that's still, you know, clearly.
What happened?
Yes, clearly. Yeah. Well, I don't think in that case, that's one where she's talking about killing herself, yeah. but it doesn't say why. There's an ongoing theme of once someone sleeps with someone, they immediately die. Because that's, you know, yeah. we were taught to fear losing your virginity.
Uh-huh. So, loss of virginity.
Yeah.
I'm sure you spent 90% of your time thinking about that.
Well, I've certainly spent 90% of my time writing about it.
Yeah.
not doing it.
Yeah.
Not making any.
Tell me about your
headway.
Friend Kay.
Oh, Kay is a pseudonym for a friend of mine in the book. She was my best friend in my freshman year of high school, and through my continued attempts to win over boys, I end up accidentally destroying that friendship, and it is definitely a huge regret that I had.
That's very universal, I think.
Yeah.
That idea of if she likes him, he's going to like me better.
Well, yeah, I don't know that I meant to do that. I really was used to being a best friend to boys, and
yeah.
I got along with guys, and so I seemed to be very surprised whenever they would then want to, you know, maybe date me.
Mm-hmm.
They had gone through all the other girls.
Yeah.
And I'm still standing there, and I write them a lot of notes. Yeah, so it took a while to learn that I was not an innocent.
And she didn't like it.
We never really spoke about it.
But you say but she dropped you.
She just sort of stopped being my friend, yeah. Without a definitive statement. So I don't even think at first I was aware that it was happening because I was so wrapped up in the relationship, yeah.
What made you aware then?
When that relationship was over a few months later, I didn't have my friend anymore.
And she wouldn't take your calls?
Yeah, you know, well, there's also something in high school where you have the summer, and then by the time you come back and it's a new school year and you're in new classes and maybe you don't see each other the same thing, mm. you're not riding the bus anymore, you don't have that forced
uh-huh.
time together, so you don't really get to confront as yeah. easily. Certainly her friends had been mean enough to me that I didn't feel
mean.
Like I could get near her. Yeah,
yeah, you got the message.
I got a message,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But life has a way of allowing you to be a top dog again when you have a book that gets published.
Well, yeah, I don't know if you call it that, but sure.
Well, at least it's surviving. So I'm going to ask you to read what happens.
Okay. Let me see if I've set this up. Yeah, so I will say that I tried to find her after. I had seen her a couple of times, and we would see each other from across the room or at a concert and not say anything.
Oh.
And once I moved out here and the internet existed, I would try to find her, and I couldn't find her. She wasn't on social media in any way, and I had known through friends that she was doing okay, but I didn't know how to reach out to her.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. So I was in Austin on my last book tour, reading from a chapter about two best friends, when I looked out at the audience and saw Kay. There she was, sitting in front of me, and I had to stop talking or I was going to break down into the ugly cry. After the reading, I finally got a chance to hug her. I cried and I told her how much I've always missed her. I told her how much I've thought about her, how I tried to find her, how important she was to me and still is, how I wouldn't be the person I am without her, and how grateful I am for her. But I don't know if I ever apologized. It never seemed like the right situation to bring up the past like that. Hi, how's your sister? Your parents? I'm sorry I stole your boyfriend in the 10th grade. Can I get you a beer? I still think about that time you had an iguana. But the truth is, I don't know if I could ever apologize enough. I don't mean about the boy, because that's not the worst thing I did. The worst thing is that when I lost her, I didn't fight with everything I had to get her back. I let her go. I let her disappear. I'll never be able to forgive myself for wasting all of that time. Time I could have had knowing her.
Do you keep in touch with her now?
I do. She asked if she's in this book. And I said, I hope that she's flattered. That she.
Is that her real name?
No, that's just a letter I'm using for her.
Yeah.
Because and everybody has pseudonyms because they don't deserve it. this is about my embarrassment and not so much theirs. But if they recognize themselves in there, I hope they know where it's coming from, a place of love. I wouldn't be here who I am without them. So.
On the other hand, you have the most embarrassing moment anyone can have. I have to say, and I'll preface it, my mother was the sort who would have intimate conversations with my sister and me when we were in the bathtub, and the only thing we could do was drown.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's with your father.
Yeah. I do have, yes, he told me, it's not really the birds and the bees, but he had the talk with me that to this day I win any contest with anyone who thinks theirs was bad.
Yeah. I mean, especially, I don't know how your mother felt or what happened.
She has asked me to never speak of it ever. So she's very patient. My mom would like to say that sometimes I write fiction, and perhaps this whole section never happened.
Oh, okay.
That's her official statement. So I have to legally say that.
And what was interesting was you came back and saw the two wedding bands mm-hmm. on the table, mm-hmm. and the next morning they were gone.
Yeah, they put them back on, yeah.
Are they both alive and still together?
No, my father passed away.
Mm-hmm.
They passed away 12 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. But he was pretty good when he was angry at you, too, because there was some stupid boy mm-hmm. who hit you.
Mm-hmm.
And he took umbrage, and afterwards he had the boy come over, and when he walked him out the door, because you said, how could you have this man who hit me coming to the house? He said, you ever touch my daughter, I'll kill you.
Yeah. Yeah, not when I was in the room, I didn't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he did. He was mad at me first.
You know,
for being in any kind of situation where I could get hurt.
But, yeah.
You know, it's interesting writing from this perspective now that I'm, you know, not the age my dad was, but I'm certainly closer to it than I was at that time.
Yeah.
So when you're young, you think it's one injustice after the other because your life you have no control over your life. And then when you get older and you think about that, now I can think about it from my dad's perspective to think, how scary it must be to not be able to see your daughter all day long and things are happening to her and there's nothing you can do about it.
Right.
But be angry afterward.
Why did he hit you?
The boy?
Yeah, that
boy.
Well,
he claims it was that he did not mean to, that he was trying to hit the other boys around me. Mm-hmm. But that I got caught in the crossfire trying to break up the fight.
But he was really a troubled kid.
Certainly in that moment he was pretty troubled, yeah.
Yeah. What happened to him in life? Did he
I don't know for sure. Yeah. You know, I only know, like, you hear through things, but I hear he's well. I hear he's fine and happy. Yeah.
And then there's...
This is why the book doesn't go into
all right.
current things. Because there are some people where I think that... I think they deserve their privacy in their current life. And so, in addition to pseudonyms and things, I try not to talk mm-hmm. about... It made it difficult, actually, in writing the book, because sometimes I could find out how they're doing. And sometimes it would make you angry, because you... You would want a different outcome for that person.
Then there is soft hair.
And then there's soft hair. Mm-hmm.
Yes. He is everybody's, he's the sort who drove up in a convertible that you could ride with your hair blowing in the wind.
He had really nice hair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And wears the best clothes and cashmere.
Right. In that year, he wore the best flannels.
All right. And yes. Now he takes you and which boy?
The nickname for the other boy is Super Mario Brothers boy, because we played a lot of video games together. Yes.
And he's going to take you on a tour of Texas, his Texas.
His Houston, yes.
And instead of it being a country club, mm-hmm. it's all the raunchy places.
Well, that's funny. Sure. But when you're in high school, it was pretty cool. An abandoned hospital that's some sort of like American Horror Story thing. And then a coffee shop, art house. There's nothing cooler. I don't know if you've seen Reality Bites, but, you know, it was set in that same area at that same time.
Just to add insult to injury, he has a guy there whom he falls all over.
Right, yes. Then I watched him kiss a man.
Dissolve. And you are in college.
Uh-huh.
And it doesn't dawn on you that maybe he's in the same sort of city where you are?
No, I didn't think he was in the same city. I didn't think of him again, really. I just assumed he went on to live his life.
If you have made up your mind that when Super Mario Boy Brother Boy comes, it's going to be your night.
Right. Yes, I waited until college. I had picked the time. The whole dorm was behind Operation Lose My Virginity. Yes.
And lo and behold, he says, did you know Soft Hair is here?
Yeah.
And he wants to take us out. There'll be a threesome of us.
No, well, not a threesome.
Oh, you don't know the way it was set up?
No. He wanted to just go over there and hang out. Yeah. You're making the book a little more scandalous. I was never cool enough to almost be in a threesome.
Yeah.
At least not. No. I'm just going to end the sentence there.
All right.
Oh, goodness. That's the sequel. But so, yeah. No, he went to go see him instead of... But I guess in his defense, I never said, I've brought you here to my dorm to sleep with me.
Well,
you think that would have worked?
Yeah, I mean, what are you going to have, a sign saying, stop at this hotel?
Well, much like Holly Hunter Boy, I just thought that who couldn't read all the signs?
Yeah.
This is love, this is magic happening right here. I've got my micro fridge with some popcorn, some smuggled beer. It was going to be, you know, the stuff of memories.
Maybe the problem was... You wanted it on your terms, and they didn't want it on your terms. Maybe it deballed them.
It did what?
Took away their manhood.
Oh, you did say deballed. I think, well, sure, but I also think I put too much emotional pressure on it, and who would want the responsibility of that? I mean, you know, those big eyes looking at you and saying, you're going to... make this very important moment happen in my life. And just on the other side of it, you got to think, can I just be the second person?
Yeah.
Third? Can you come back when you've had someone else disappoint you?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've never been a teenage boy, but I can imagine.
Yeah.
There are some kinds who are, and that just, I think, speaks to that they were nice boys.
Yeah. Because
there's certainly the guy who would be like, yeah,
you're
I'll
married now.
I am married now.
How does he
Sorry, get? Everybody.
True. How did you meet him?
We met through a mutual friend. Yes.
Yeah.
And I decided I would try the opposite of all my instincts. And it worked. And however, about 6 months into our relationship, he started to realize that maybe he saw these notes and realized I was actually way more emotional and sensitive than I had been leading him to believe. But by then, you know.
Playing the game.
I'd never played a game before. And I don't know that it was a game. I was trying to keep myself from putting too much pressure on him and myself.
Yeah.
Like, let's just let this be something. Grown-ups seem to be able to have nice relationships where they date for a little while. I'd never really done that. So I tried dating.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But then, you know, certainly at one point, so what's happening here? You know, never the real me is going to come out.
Well, the real you got scared. When those guys said to you, get in our car, and you were returning back
the two videos. Yeah, you're talking about a time that I was walking home, or I was walking to the video store to return a videotape. I was 14 or 15 at the time.
Yeah.
And these boys kind of pulled me into their car, yeah.
And you finally got out and got home.
Mm-hmm.
But they followed a couple of days later.
No, right after. They were right on my heels and then broke into the house through the window. Yeah. You know, I think about that time in Texas, and everybody's parents worked, and we were a lot of kids who were making grown-up decisions and living alone for long hours.
What is it?
Latchkey kids. Yeah. I guess I don't even know if people say that anymore, but it was a small enough town that people didn't really worry too much.
Yeah.
And so kids had a lot of freedom.
But somebody did save you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and my dad was really upset about that one too. That was certainly the first time I'd seen him.
Yeah.
It was the first time I saw him cry. Yeah.
Now that you're here at this age, how did it feel reading these over again?
Well, I guess it really did take me back to when I felt stuck when 4 years feels like you're never going to get to the end of high school. I mean, so much life happens in that time, and who you are changes so many times.
Yeah.
And so I could watch that through those letters and see myself trying to be a certain person, and maybe I'll be this kind of person or that kind of person. And so sometimes it's embarrassing because you know you're trying to pull off something that you're just not. Mm-hmm. But I'm grateful for that version of me, because I think she was pretty fearless.
Yeah.
At times.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. When she talks up to a teacher and says,
I don't think I'd do it now.
Well, I would hope you would, because here was this bigot teaching history in high school and sort of saying slavery wasn't all that bad.
Yeah, it wasn't that bad. That's what
she said. And you spoke up.
I did. I had, well, and it wasn't the only, I guess it was a tonnage issue. There had been enough instances where I just started to feel at that point that when I saw people writing it down, like it was going to be on the test. I think that's what I was really upset about. Like, don't make me have to pick the wrong answer on a test. I don't want to get a B just because I have to say false, slavery wasn't that bad.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then get told that's wrong. I really wanted good grades, and I loved teachers in school, so it was heartbreaking. It was a big breakup.
And you were trying to start a school newspaper.
I did. I tried to start an underground newspaper to talk about school injustices, but I didn't have any ability. Yeah. No one. I only could handwrite copies.
And today, you were also, working for Disney?
Yeah, I don't know that they want that in the same sense, but yes. I am writing a Disney animation. I'm writing on a feature over there.
From an original story or based on?
They're director-driven films, so that it's created in-house, and then at a certain point they bring a writer in to help.
How did you get into Disney? I mean, to go there and be on Dopey Street and...
That's right, that's right. It is, it's an amazing piece of history. Through the regular channels, I had a script that people liked, and then I went in, and they had read a couple of scripts, actually. They had read a feature, and then they read a half-hour pilot that has some talking cats in it.
So
one was about my family, and then one was about talking cats. But they're grown-up. I mean, it's a grown-up talking cat comedy.
Do you write alone?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I write alone, yeah.
Yeah. We can't write it 200 pages because no script's supposed to be that long.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. Now, I write shorter letters now.
Yeah.
But I wrote a 200-page note to one boy and a 205-page note to another.
Pam, you are an absolute delight, and this book is just adorable, and I loved it, and I thank you.
Will you
autograph it
for
absolutely.
Me? Oh, absolutely. Thank you. Thanks
and
for having me.
If you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinsonTalksBooks. You can also read some of our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. And if you want to see the shows, go to YouTube Connie Martinson's channel. If you want to see some of the 5,000 older ones, go to Claremont Graduate University's Digital Library. They are digitizing shows that have been on what they call 3/4 inch, which after a few years turns to dust, which would be really criminal to lose some of the people that were on those 3/4 inch machines. But support your local library. Go in, take out a card. That's also how they get funding. Donate books to them. Donate your time. They can really use it. And if you have a child, take them to the library to get them a library card. they will learn you take a book out in good condition, you return it in good condition on time. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Oh, that's exactly where my mom took me when I was very little. And we used to get big, giant stacks of books. And we still do that, actually. I help run a charity that helps libraries in need.
Oh, really?
It's called the Dewey Donation System. And we find libraries that have lost their circulation budget and have wish lists up for books that they need. And then we, through the internet, get people to donate.
And
to
if
help
somebody hearing this wants to join or help, where do they go?
You go to DeweyDonationSystem.org.
Dewey?
DeweyDonationSystem.org. Like the Dewey Decimal System, but the donation system. We try once a year to do a book drive for a charity. We've done New Orleans in the past, and we did India after the tsunami. We did San Diego after the wildfires. And so we try to find a library that's been hard hit and help
that
out.
That's marvelous. I mean, because nothing is more vital than to see books burned.
Yeah.
I mean, that's Nazis, not life.
Right.
Yeah.
We're flooded. Yeah, and the library is such the center of the community, and it's how people get back on their feet when, you know, that's where people apply for jobs and take their kids.
And if you don't know how to use a computer, they will teach you, and they will have computers at the library to use.
That's right, yeah.
Bravo for you, Pam.
And thanks for promoting libraries. That's great.
And we'll see you next week. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, thanks.